So as I mentioned a few months ago, I had to get set up. I have a couple week long house sitting mini arc for myself that I've got pretty much set doing. And then right now it's just me and the small cat, and we're gonna be talking about the new chapter because one for my favorite thing, confirmation, strong confirmation of my man Zero. I know that there are some of those people that, unless we have like a firm, like straight, oh yeah, this is him, they're gonna be like, well, we don't know for sure. I feel like it's very clear. When you see the dude with the same hair, and he's got the same face, and the same forehead shape, nose shape, he's this pretty much the same guy. He looks like the same guy, just the way they're drawing him. And I don't know. I don't know how anybody could look at that and not have been like, oh yeah, that's very clearly Zero of all people. So I'm very happy about that, because too, like, not only did he come back, like, he's got a little bit of character development. I'm a little bit curious about that. I kind of think, at least my theory, just how we see him, is that because Brain had the dark skin while Zero had white skin, and at least based off what we're seeing, I think as the demon, the two of them kind of fused into one being, because Zero should, at least as far as we know, be like the real kind of main personality. So Brain becoming a more kind of back burner addition into him, because Zero, when we first saw him, was just all destruction. He just wanted to destroy. He had no real reason to it. He enjoyed the game. He enjoyed seeing stuff just get completely demolished and seeing stuff with form crumble. He's one of those villains where he doesn't have to be complex. You don't have to have a million things leading up to him. Really, he appears for like a like one volume, and he's a fun fight. He's just dedicated in how he's presented to where he is that kind of villain, and he is gonna go off of, how he's presented. He's not just gonna be like, oh, I'm a big evil bad guy, I just want to destroy stuff, and then he loses in 5 seconds. Oh no, he had a good run. He went and he wrecked pretty much the entire main cast for the most part, bar Erza, and then he just goes and shows that he can toy around with Natsu. Jalal's still not enough, and then he fights Dragon Force Natsu for a while before Natsu kind of really gets the full kind of grip on where he's at. It was just really cool, and I really like characters like that, where it's like you have a guy, he's not supposed to be in for a long time, he's, a surprise boss, or maybe he's just a straightforward and he's a bad guy, but you really kind of stick with it, and it's like, yeah, this guy's clearly just a jerk, but he really plays the spot for it. I always liked that about Zero, and like seeing him back, and he's kind of being thankful to Ferris about reviving him, which is really cool. I thought that was really neat in just how he's presented, because again, he has development like straight out of when he comes back, because we never really got him in any other point in the series. When you look at the whole bit with the Starry Sky, not the Starry Sky arc. Oh no, sorry, the Starry Sky arc. Almost got the Eclipse Spirits and the Starry Sky arc mixed up. But with the whole Erastion Space Reborn, LaPointe wasn't actually Brain or Zero. It was just a fake made using his hair. And once they got out in Tartaros, Zero never actually got out. That was all an illusion. So we haven't actually had Zero since the whole Nirvan Erastion Space arc. And that's just kind of crazy to think that long, and then he's finally back, and then like the first thing we actually get from him, he's showing of being more than a one-dimensional character, which is really cool. I really am excited to see the general spread of the fights. I think that the three faction war is really cool because we don't know who's gonna go where, and I really like the idea of not just having main cast members fighting these guys. I really want to see just a member of Fire and Flames and one of the Erastion sects fighting. I think that would be really cool. Or maybe even like a member of Diabolus in there. I want to have some that aren't just the Fairy Tail member cast in there. Obviously, they're the main cast, but I think it'll be really cool if we see more of the characters spread out through the arc itself. If because we should have generally in belief, I would say, from what Mishima talked about, a really long run with this spread, because we're going to have each of the Dragon Gods that are going to have to be figured out. We have Ignia still. We have each member of Fire and Flames. Ferris is another thing. And I still believe that Fire and Flames has a couple members we don't know about, for one. And I believe that Ferris has a couple demons that we don't know about, because she can just create them. And really, when you look at the two sides, all Fire and Flames members have to be are fire users that are dedicated and loyal to Ignia and have the conviction for their whole goal. And when you look at that, it's not like the Spriggan 12. The Spriggan 12 were, oh yeah, these amazing wizards and creatures and beings from across the continent all gathered. They're all special in some way, shape, or form. You know, you have someone like Brandish, who is just a prodigy. She's just a prodigy in all her capabilities. And you have Irene, who is a dragon, you know, dragon magic, mother, creator, sage dragon, 400-year-old plus being with wisdom and capabilities beyond what most beings ever would aspire to even, like even think of what they were capable of. And with both sides, like, you have Ferris, because Ferris can just take a dead body, turn that into a demon, or she can just make one. Which, we do also find in this chapter, the only one of the members of the new OS are... they're all Aetherius, like raw Aetherius, and the only one that was made from a corpse of any kind was Zero, which I thought was really interesting, because it's nothing, like, kind of crazy in kind of, like, design. It's more... My cats. My little cat likes to go over near one of my dogs, and he really wants to... He's one of those dogs where he wants to play with him, but he doesn't understand that he's a giant compared to him. But he doesn't mean bad. I almost lost my train of thought. I didn't this time. But with, oh crap, I almost did. Oh no. With Fire and Flames and the OS, oh, I almost lost my train of thought. I like had it for a second, almost lost it, rebounded like twice. That's like the danger zone of when you almost lose it and it's just right on the tip of your tongue. But no, with the difference between the two of them is it opens up the possibility for any characters that have died to be brought back as new demons that she can use. Please, 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 please bring Genma back. I love the idea of Genma coming back again and he fights somebody and he's beaten in one chapter again. Personally, for me, I had the idea of a character, like, if I ever did a story, it's like you have one guy who somehow, like, every arc, this one goon, like, almost every arc, maybe there's, like, an arc you wouldn't see him, he's like, and you're like, what is he doing? And he somehow just moves up the goon ladder, and he somehow is almost in every arc, he almost has a fight every arc, he's slightly more powerful, he gets, like, some new thing by joining the next bad guy group. And you continuously just see this guy, and he's just a loser that keeps failing upwards. And I think with Genma, that would be so funny. I would love to see that. Because, one, I gotta be honest, and this is the only thing that Genma has going for him. His designs are cool. I love his demon design. His normal design when he was a human is cool. I still love his demon design. He gives off this such a cool, like... primitive, savage, forest, like, elf troll creature. And I love that about him. I think he looks really cool in his demon form. It was a shame he didn't get an Aetherius form. I imagine maybe he's kind of like Minerva. Maybe they didn't have it because they weren't fully complete, or what was it going on? Because we know from Doriath they should have an Aetherius form, but maybe there's, like, a different step for the artificial ones. There's still area in that we don't know. Like, we did get lore this chapter that... once you enter being a black wizard, you are no longer officially human, which is really interesting because we have stuff in the series that sets that apart from regular magics, and that's part of lost magic. But with black magic, we've never really had anything that differs it that much from other magics. Like, lost magic has its own taboos and its own drawbacks and dangers. And that's one of the reasons why they're dangerous, is because they were so powerful, but the drawbacks were so risky, they were a threat in all areas. Like, yeah, this person can get it and is now so much more powerful, so much more scary to be within whatever position they're in. But then the, for the people that are, you know, on their side, they're like, well, now if this person does X, Y, or Z, they could die just from the drawback of their magic. Look at someone like Zoldio. When Zoldio came out of Capricorn, well, at that point he was in Leo, and he just faded out. He just dissipated because he broke taboo of his magic. Or with Azuma, and Azuma ended up getting his body just merging in and becoming trees, and then he died. Like, stuff like that is the, one of the reasons why lost magic is lost magic. They ended up intentionally trying to get it forgotten within the history of their world, and it's part of the reason that it's so highly regarded within the verse of fairy tale. But with black magic, we really don't have a lot of the whole areas that make it as different. The only thing we really know is that there seems to be more drawbacks in terms of the price to pay with them, such as like how law, like fairy law and grimoire law, you end up shaving off more of your lifespan the more enemies you hit. And it's more of like a AoE target kind of like price. And we don't know if there's like, if it's literally just like, you know, if one guy, if like one fodder guy and one really powerful guy like go for the same number, like how exactly it kind of determines how much it takes away. But we know that like that's a black magic. We know that devil slaying is a type of black magic because it will curse you and it will slowly corrupt your heart and your soul and it will turn you into a demon. And we have stuff like that, but we never had anything that was as concrete, you know, anything kind of hard setting. Like when, for example, is like when we had during the Mimi fight, the first round, we have the whole bit where Lucy is like, was told like her spirits will grow automatically in strength her, because it's like, they're both kind of like Pokemon, where it's like both the wizard's capability of the, and the bonds. I was going to say, and the spirits, but that's kind of different. It's kind of weird because the spirits, if they summon themselves, they're kind of their own innate power of how they are on their own. And then a wizard could summon them, but if like a fodder wizard summons them, they could be weaker. But if a stronger wizard summons them, then they're going to be augmented. But it's also increased by the bond between the spirit and the summoner, and being close to each other makes them stronger as well. There's a two-factor bit in there. And that's something we've always generally known, but it's just straight hard confirmed, just straight told to us. I believe that there's like a part in the anime that mentions it, but it's kind of like an additional scene, so it's never really like, it's one of those parts where it's like, is it canon, is it not? But we get it hard confirmed. Another example is like with dragon slaying magic. It turns you dragon-like. It alters your DNA and your body composition. And we know for a fact that once you start using dragon slaying magic to a point, you are no longer technically human. You are a new species, pretty much. And we know that from even as early as Edelis I always call him Doriath. When Byro was talking about it, he was saying how their body, you know, the Dragon Slayer bodies were remarkable because they are both human and not human, obviously, because they are between the state of becoming a dragon and being a human. That's the whole bit with them. And with this chapter, we found out with Ferris is saying when she, whatever she did with Acnologia's arm, because I don't think she's a fifth gen. We still haven't gotten anything on the fact that her arm looks mechanical. I'm so intrigued by that, of like, what is the reveal going to be with that? Is she like a machine creature? I personally really like the idea of Ferris is kind of like my thing with Ivan. I always really like the idea if Ivan came back and Ivan was more powerful because he just does all of these risky things. Like he uses devil particles, turns himself into a demon, gets a bunch of like drug augments from like the spinoffs, gets like magic tools and like lost magic, gets second origin unlock, finds like every single cheat code he can and every single thing to just fast pass his way into strength, and that's how he could be a relevant villain again, even if in one fight. I always like the idea of that, but maybe that's what Ferris did, and she just has like these ways where she would do black magic research, figure out a way for her to jump a step forward, and then obviously with Acnologia's arm, that's pretty much the ultimate fast pass step forward. But it's weird that hers isn't like a dragon arm. It's like mechanical. It's machine like. It's very strange about that. We still have no real explanation of why that is. But I'm intrigued. But maybe she has something like that where she just has multiple kind of like little cheat codes going on at the same time, and she's able to get her way with that. Hold on, I'm actually gonna turn off this light. This thing is bright. That is much better. I noticed how bright it was for a second. It was really getting on my nerves. But we have Ferris now, as she explains that at that point she became a black wizard, and once you become a black wizard, you're no longer officially human. Again, very interesting, because it gives us the whole bit where does that mean that something as you become a black wizard is different about your magic? Like maybe you have tainted magic, like your magic itself is black, kind of a thing. We don't really know like what that really like fully entails. Like maybe there's a point where you can use certain black magic normally, but you can't use a level of black magic until you become a black wizard. Maybe like living magic and making demons like the Aetherius. I think that would make a lot of sense, and it would be consistent of, oh well, the only people that we've ever seen use living magic to this degree are Xerath and Ferris, and these are the two black wizards that we know about. No other person using black magic has been called a black wizard like this. So again, this is something that's really cool. It adds to the lore and to the world building, as well as with Zero, we see that apparently Nirvana and like getting the black influence of Nirvana like turns him into a demon, which is very interesting, because I wonder what that really kind of like builds out to, because we obviously didn't see it for the little short period of time that he was escaped in Tartaros, but maybe that's because it was Zero specifically, and Brain kind of holds that back. Or maybe it was kind of like Mira Jane, when Mira Jane became demonic when she had devil particles brought into her body when she was younger. And it's more like that. It's more of a kind of like base compatibility alteration, and not so much as like, yeah, I'm a demon now and I got all these demonic bits now growing out of me. Like you officially kind of enter a demonic state. Kind of like how Franmont talked about how Hades was the human closest to being a demon without being a demon. So maybe something like that, which is again one of those bits. Like maybe Hades, because Hades could only use black magic, like and stuff from the Book of Xerath when he was using the his eye, is he only could do it artificially, and he never became a black wizard in his pursuits because he was using lost magic and not really using black magic except when his eye was open. So maybe there's something there that he really understood is dangerous when using black magic. Like maybe what he was avoiding was the whole bit about it corrupting your heart and your mind, and he didn't want to stray from what his path was. Because maybe he's like, if I use a bunch of black magic without the devil eye and the heart intact, it's gonna corrupt me. I'm gonna become a black wizard, and maybe that'll completely change my goals, and I'll turn against Xerath or something. Because that would make sense if he became a black wizard and he's like, well, instead now of reviving Xerath, I want to do my own thing, and I want to go and take over and start my own kind of setup. And Hades didn't want to do that because he already has a belief of like, no, this is correct. I think that's actually a really cool theory, really, when you think about it, just because it adds like a little bit to Hades, just from, again, the question of if he was at this state, why didn't he go forward, whereas Zero was and did? Because I don't imagine, just based off of what we saw, that Zero knows more about turning into like essentially like just black magic and demonic influence and all that, even close to Hades. Brain, I don't think Brain would know as much. I think Brain has direct access to more information, but Hades, I think, just would know more from being way older, and he has that giant library archive. So everything that he already has, he's pretty much able just to be like, oh yeah, I've already read that. I've already read that. I've already got all this stuff under my belt. Whereas maybe Brain would have to be like, oh, I have to go research this, and he has all the ways to research it, kind of as a guy. Because Brain was smart, and he clearly was more of like the tactical, scientisty, experimental schemer, but he doesn't seem like he's as I guess I want to say just generally well educated in the vastness of magic overall as Hades. Hades just seemed to be a complete talent when it came to like being that guy, just to be like, oh yeah, I can name this. I know all these things. Kind of like he's in that same kind of area of like Jalal and Xerath, whereas like August could instantly learn it. August wasn't, from whatever when we saw him, wasn't somebody that could just give off the aura of being more of an intellectual. He was obviously more of somebody that had more of like a dominating presence, and he was at his own thing. I liked when he was more of like the grandpa, and he just was this nice old dude. But he doesn't have that same level of just seemingly like tactical, kind of like brilliance that Hades had. Hades had a lot more of that kind of vibe out of all of like the villains. Mardgear is probably the only one I would say is more so than Hades, just because Mardgear was way more capitalizing on like, I'm a tactician, I like look at all my tactical decisions and all my planning and stuff. And Tartarus did last longer and perform a lot better than I almost said Serious Island, than Grimoire Heart overall. But yeah, we had a lot in this chapter just to give in the core of these guys, and we haven't even talked about their names. Like I said, I really liked the first bit about well, not the first bit, because it started with what. Let me pull up the chapter, because I think we started with the main cast, right? I know it's already been 20 minutes, but I feel like everybody that's been reading, like, this arc has been so cool so far, so heat. Everything that we've had has been absolutely fantastic. Like, it has really been just a consistently, every chapter has been hitting with new information, cool stuff just rolling in. Like, all the different fights, like I was talking about, it's just cool to see, like, theorize who's going to be doing what where. Are we gonna get someone like Blade? Is he gonna be fighting Urza? Because the sword, yeah, we're gonna have swords, but he's a demon, so it's like, oh, is it gonna be Gray fighting it? Personally, I'm really hoping that Mishima keeps the characters kind of separated on like who's gonna be fighting with the dragons and who's gonna be fighting the demons. I would like Urza to be more focused on the dragons because she has the Belsarion sword, and I really don't want her to fight many of the demons. I'm really hoping Mishima just pulls like unexpected but expected cards out of the back pocket, like, oh, for this demon, like, say let's say for Zero, the two people I would say I want him to fight, Gray, which I think Gray would be really cool. I would really like to see a really good Zero fight with Gray, just because, like, obviously I want to see, like, Zero has so many things I want to talk about just about him in general, what we're going to see that's different. Obviously he's going to have his old abilities, but what is he going to have that's new? He should have an Aetherius form, which I can't wait to see. He's got the tattoo marks. I assume those are the same things where when they go down, he's going to unlock something, maybe his Aetherius, who knows. But either Gray, because I think that would just be really cool. I'd love to see Gray fight a stronger version of somebody that Natsu fought in one of, at least for me, one of the most memorable fights. And Gildarts. I think Gildarts would be really cool if he popped up and we had him in a fight, because he's a guy similar of age as to Zero. So we would see like a really cool just clash of unexpecteds. Because it's, I really want to see like just the sides divert. I want to see like an honest split with the teams kind of separated. And almost like each of the characters have their own mini arc. Because I don't expect any of the main cast members to fight any of the Dragon Gods 1v1 except Natsu. I really just don't see, like Lucy's going to where Merc is. I don't see any way that Lucy could do anything unless Lucy, like, the only way I can see it is if Lucy essentially gets set up to get, like, a insane main character power-up, and it's just enough to kind of get Merc in the right sense of mind. Like, say, like, it's just enough to kind of push Merc back and use Merc kind of like how Wendy used Easel to throw him through the face structure. And it's just enough to force Merc back and destroy the Lacrima. Maybe it doesn't hurt Merc, but it takes the mind control off him. And it's like, oh, well, even for one attack, she was able to overpower him. It didn't do damage when it means like, oh, she's able to push back a Dragon God. That's a feat in itself. Doesn't have to be, oh yeah, she defeats in one shot. It's kind of hard to say. Like, Lucio is always somebody that, like, we know that she has crazy potential in her magic, and we know that Celestial Spirit magic in the end is super broken. If you somehow, like, what is it, you get all 13 keys, and theoretically you have, like, manipulation over space and time to what extent we don't know, but like, could she just do an eclipse, like, to a degree? Who knows what she could do? Like, there's weird stuff that we don't know entirely that is capable with celestial spirit magic, and it should be a lost magic at this point. I don't see it happening, but I see, like, if there's a way that she does, there's, like, a bunch of crazy parts that go into it, and like, Lucy gets, like, Celestial Spirit King Star Dress or something like that. But I don't see her winning. My thing is, like, the best case scenario is I think that they destroy the Lacrima. At a point, they stop. I think they only get to a point where they can stop the dragon gods from all being under the influence of it. We get Merc and Selene back, but then Ignia gets Alderaan and Viernes on their sides, or maybe they're kind of independent, which I think would be really cool, because I still really think that after a point we should get another time skip, and we could see, like, oh yeah, return each of the dragon gods rule, like, an area, and not, like... Imagine it's, like, Natsu versus Alderaan rematch, and he walks in by himself and, like, 1v1s Alderaan, and this is, like, peak Natsu. This is, like, Goku coming up, showing up during, like, the Namek saga. He's just fully, like, oh, no, I'm the guy right now. Everyone get out of the way. And he just completely just... Because, personally, I think... I know people are gonna... I mentioned, like, Ultra Instinct. I think Goku was at, like, his cool, his best of I'm that guy in Namek. I mean, I really don't feel like anybody can make an argument with that. Like, maybe part of Saiyan Saga, but I don't think so, because he was still gapped by Vegeta for really a lot of that fight. And then with Frieza, like, there was a difference between once he was getting kind of beat and then getting Super Saiyan. I don't need to talk about Dragon Ball too much. But just for how it's set up, I would love to see something like that. It'd be really cool. Because I, personally, too... I think Ignia's plans, because we know Ignia's plan about fighting Natsu to the death and burning the planet to ash, that's not going to happen. But I think it's obviously, like, Natsu's going to defeat him. The bad guy's going to lose in the end. We all know that. He's not going to get his everybody dies and it's just him ruling over a mound of ashes, like, end. But I believe that he is going to get his bit about the dragon world getting set up and getting his dragon nation. Because I believe that Mishima's setting up for, like, a next stage where we have the world with the dragons back. And I think that would be really cool. There's a lot that we could work with that for story and just events, world building, everything around that would be really cool. So once we get to a point, there's going to be a bunch of dragons still up around. We're going to have dragons back. Because it's not like you need to keep spawning people into dragons for the next 5 years. You really only need... what, like, a couple hundred, and then, like, you have people, and we don't know how many of them are going to be fully aware of themselves, and how many of them are just going to be kind of rampaging animals. Rampaging animals, man, there you have, like, rampaging, no real intelligence dragons flying out there. They're going to be breeding the second they get a chance, and they're just going to start bringing back the race. And I really am hoping that we get that point. I think that's going to happen, and we're going to have Ignia's winning on that point, because I think that's why we have Igni with these multiple set goals, because this way he has stuff he can't accomplish, and then we know his ultimate goal. It's like there's no way that he's gonna get that victory, because that means that he won and everybody just dies. But I do think the dragon scenario is going to be accomplished by him, but that's gonna lead into it, because I think it too, that's the best way for Natsu to go from where he's at to being dragon god tier, is you get him a world with all these dragons for him to fight. And it's so he's able just to figure out, like, oh, well, this is a dragon that I can one-tap. This is easy for me. Oh, here's one that I can kind of fight normally. And he can just kind of keep going and pushing the ladder until he's at that stage to where he's able just to run over regular dragons. Because we know with... It's hard to fully kind of say where he's at for a dragon god in total, because we know Dogermag is the bar. Dogermag is the bar for dragon god level, and Natsu and Suzaku together beat him. It was with a unison raid, so it's like them fused, but still, that still says, I would say, like, because Natsu wasn't using dragon force, but still, it's a unison raid. It's kind of its own thing. You can still say that would mean that either of them... normally, against Dogermag, you know, Dogermag not all buffed up with his Dragon Lacrima, his Dogra cores, they would be able to have a reasonable fight with him. You know, by themselves, they wouldn't be able to win, but they still have a reasonable way of being able to contend with them. And so Natsu going from that spot to where he could actually once, you know, 1v1 Alderaan in a fight, I think it'd be perfect for him to have a whole setup of all these other dragons for him to, you know, go around and fight and then kind of just really get a firm grasp on all of his capabilities. But besides that, we have all the names of the new characters. And yeah, the chapter did start with Elefseria and the main cast, and they're just kind of going over everything that's happened. I like what he said. He said the sky glowed and the ether nanoparticles evaporated. I thought that was just a really cool detail. Also, as just a side note, we do have Athena. We have Athena. Like, so we have somebody fully that should be capable of being able to contend with a dragon god. Like, at least as, like, a, hey, put that person in there because they are an actual, like, they will give very strong, reasonable addition to the fight. Like, she has dragon slaying abilities, so it's like she can do damage. We don't know if she has, like, some crazy ult move where she turns into a damn Gundam, but we know how she fights, you know, from at least a little bit. She can fly, and she has, like, these cool dragon slaying magic guns, cannon things. And she has alchemy. Like, she's got some cool stuff that she can bring to the table and that they can go do. Obviously, I feel like she has to go fight Viernes or Alderaan. Personally, I think Alderaan, because I think we could get some really cool scenes of her flying around Alderaan's body and, you know, getting all these gunshots on him. Like this is like a sci-fi movie. I think that'd be really cool. But right now, the fights, I would say, I think Wendy has to fight Viernes. Wendy's the only one that can really go and do anything towards Viernes. I thought Lucy would be with Celine, but I guess not. So probably Urza, Celine, Rey, Alderaan, Natsu, Ignea, and then Lucy's around Celine. They're not going to fight the Drag Gods, obviously. They're just going to go destroy the Lacrima. And, like, really the best case scenario I can see for them, at least right now, is they destroy the Lacrima. There's a limited number of dragons. I assume that all of the member Fire and Flames are dragons now, and they have full dragon capabilities. And they get Celine and Merc back on their side so they can kind of get to a spot. Because the thing about that is, too, if they get this set up, the problem is they have a side with three dragon gods. And still, we still have a question mark on Dogermag. I still want to keep my fingers crossed that Dogermag is going to be involved, too. I like him. I really want to see him back. And so, you know, the side with two dragon gods. So it's like if Natsu... Because think about this. Imagine we had Natsu come back, time skip, Natsu's Dragon God level, and you have essentially 3v4, but you really, it's like Dogermag, he's like half a point, so it's like 3.5 Dragon Gods. Natsu 1v1s and defeats Dogermag, and then we have 3v3, essentially, and then it's like, well, okay, well, we have to figure out what we need to do of defeating them without, you know, just, you know, going to an all-in bloodbath kind of match. There's a lot to that I think that there's value and a lot of that we could really kind of see come up. You know, again, that's going to be a while. But I think that, like, otherwise, like, their plan of going to destroy the Lacrima, I think, is a good idea. Because they're not like, yeah, we're going to go 1v1 each of the dragon gods. Because Elisera even mentions, like, no, they're even stronger than before. This should be their true power. And so now everybody is stronger than where they were before. And I don't really see what they could do, because everybody is more powerful than where they were when they tried to fight Merc-Phobia at the start, but I don't think that really any of them have a chance 1v1-ing any dragon god. Natsu does, only because he's got, like, the whole innate whole bit with his dragon abilities and his Aetherius abilities, you know, as we saw with the Merc-Phobia fight. So that's something that we have to, like, okay, that's a possibility. But everybody else, like, I don't see. So going after the Lacrima is good, but going after the Lacrima alone, I think, is not the best idea. Because it's like, I feel like if you had me, you know, just kind of sit down and talk to them, I'd be like, everybody in the room, I think, is capable of handling the Lacrima. The problem is... what about all the other commotion? What happens when one of the dragon gods gets in the way? That's the thing I'm like, you guys really, really are kind of like banking on like you show up and it not get too much into trouble. But I mean, like, this is their, they said this is the fastest way. I think that they definitely, here's the thing too, I feel like we're gonna get something like, yeah, on the way there, because we, one thing just to mention, and I don't really have a lot to say about the very beginning of the chapter other than like the first little bits about LF Saria talking about like the dragon gods are stronger than they were before, their full power, their true power, which I think is cool. But other than that, it's like, yeah, the main cast is splitting up. They're gonna go and take care of the Lacrima. Pretty straightforward there. But once we get back to it, like, Lucy is already in Ermina, and that took a couple days to get there. Now, we have the fact that LF Saria can teleport people. Yes, we know that. But I believe that because we don't see like a good portion of, hey, let's head out to, okay, now we've arrived. I mean, I think that was intentional. Personally, and this is my belief, that we're going to be getting other characters added into each of the main cast members to aid them, which I think makes sense. But I would hope that they at least sent out a little bit of like, hey, guys, here's the plan. Like a handful of people, like maybe they got in touch with members of Diablos. Maybe they got in touch with like, you know, maybe Jalal ended up, you know, being like, hey, I heard what happened, and like communicated real fast and maybe grabbed some people from the guild. Who knows? Like any form of like, hey, word, like, can somebody kind of like, you know, meet up with us? Like, can someone intercept and convene with us over here so we can try and take care of this? Because I feel like with Lucy, like, I feel like Brandish is going to come back. I feel like Brandish is the easy one that's going to come help Lucy. I really hope Kyria shows up. I really like the idea of Kyria showing up. It's like, I really liked Kyria as a character pretty much all through 100 Years Quest, except from the beginning when she was just kind of like this sadistic evil person. And then we kind of like saw more of what was going on. Then we saw more of like her not being a crazy battle character, and then just all these different sides to her. And then after Lucy beat her, she like has a level of respect for him. I'm like, okay, that's pretty admirable. Like, she's like this complete lunatic in battle, and she's an asshole to anybody that's weaker than her. But then she's like, you know what? You're all right. It's like she's okay with somebody that beat her, and like she's completely accepting of it. I like that about her. She's a neat character, and that's one of the reasons too. I like the pretty much all of Diablos as a guild, but we need something for Lucy really bad, and I'll get to talking about Lucy in a minute because I want to talk a little bit further about the Erastion sex real fast. So Ferris is talking about them. Obviously, their plan is they want to create a world of black wizards, which is very interesting, because what is that plan for then? Because I talked about how like it sounded like she was going to do like the Great World of Magic, but hers sounds a little different, because the Great World of Magic in theory is magic at its primordial state, to where it's so chaotic and crazy, only the strongest wizards can survive, which creates these, you know, again, the strongest wizards. So you're only going to see strong wizards. You're not going to have these random little goofy guys who know a couple spells and do it for like an entertainer job or something. Because Hades didn't like how magic it was at the state that it was, and it felt that it was wrong, that it was almost domesticated and mundane instead of being at this glorified and renowned and, you know, almost worship state. And from what we're seeing with Ferris is she wants to make this world of only black wizards, which again is like, what is it just like this kind of world of uncontrolled chaos, which I think is really cool, because like the difference with those two is you have this world of like, you know, strength and chaos, where it's like, oh, it's so crazy, only people who are able to be powerful enough to survive are going to be the ones around, where hers is like she wants just to have everyone be these wild card crazy powerful wizards that are just, you never know what's going on, and like every, you know, just imagine like all these OP villains just walking around, and you know, by the dozens, and they're just causing absolute havoc. Like, it'll be really cool too if Ferris gets her way in partial, and maybe she does something that's like, oh, I've done X, you know, this thing, and it every once in a while it will come out and it will pulse and it will create black wizards, and it's like she makes this kind of permanent effect on the world that will just naturally, you know, if you go in this area, it's like, oh, it'll taint your magic and it will turn you evil. I think that'd be really cool. I think that'd be really cool for just the world building if she taints some land that it's like, oh, if you go there, it's like radioactive evil magic kind of thing. I think that'd be badass. But the guys, let's talk about these villains, man. So the first one, Gaia. I like that he has like this very goonish face. Like he's just this big chin dude with these lumpy things on his head, and he's got these back spikes and this Toguro mega neck shoulder mantle thing. And he's talking about how like he wants to make a world overflowing with love, which is interesting that he has this very positive mindset for a guy that looks like he'd be like straight cold evil. The girl Blade, or sorry, I got my guys mixed up. The girl Damon, who says like she doesn't need love as long as she has black, she'll melt. Which again, I don't know what that's supposed to really mean. I mean, I know understand that this is supposed to be, hey, here's our. We only get like one, maybe two bubbles of speech each. Here's just a kind of thing to understand our character personality and our thing. But I'm like, this is like the way that she's saying it's like, I wonder what she means by that. I don't know. Maybe her power is like over the color black, and that's what she means. It's like some weird color manipulation curse. We have Bird, who. This guy I have no hope for. Maybe he'll be one of those dudes who's like. Completely flips my expectations, but like he has the least intricate design. Because like even with Gate, he has this kind of he has that obvious very very clean, not scary face kind of, but also there's a level of menace to it because he looks almost too non-threatening, and you know there's a danger there. I really like Blade just because he looks cool. He looks kind of like a weird vampire Stern Ritter, and I think that's just neat. And then obviously Zero. I mean, like I like all their designs. Damon's design is okay. I feel like she's gonna be one of those characters. Her Aetherius form is way better than her regular design, and her regular design is just supposed to be kind of hot girl for the most part. But her Aetherius is gonna be really sick. Maybe it'll be like once she uses her powers, because just at least from what we saw, she just doesn't look too stand out to me. But maybe again, that's just from the fact that we really only have like intro bits with her. But like this dude Bird is just named Bird, and his like he just has like a bird body. He just kind of looks like a Tegu, but with a bird head. He looks just like a random Yu-Gi-Oh card. And again, maybe he'll surprise me. I'm fully open. If this guy ends up being cool, I will give him the credit he deserves. But right now, he's the one that I have the least stocks into. I feel like at least from what we've seen, he's gonna get embarrassed by Wendy, and he's gonna be the one that Wendy is like, I have a chance to dominate my opponent and try out new moves, and she's just gonna be testing stuff and like slapping this dude around. Blade is cool. I really liked again his design. We don't really get anything kind of crazy from him. He has a very straightforward statement that he'll cut people down with his demonic sword. Again, nothing really telling at all. I really do like his weird snake sword, so I'm hoping it has a really cool effect. I'm trying to think of what it'd be. Maybe, because here's one thing I want to say. The Uchiha chapter, I feel like could just have been an Uchiha Fun chapter. I do think that there is something to the Cobra chapter. Like there could be Ichia could show up at some point, like and be support. I really like the idea of when we get into a lot of these bigger fights that lots of characters. Like I really want it to be. I really like the idea of like once we get to like a big fight, like say one of the Fire and Flames members shows up and they fight Lucy after Caramel or whatever, and Lucy has none of the other main cast. And she has all these support members in there. You have like Brandish and Kiria, but maybe like because of reasons, we have a couple random support characters. Like, oh, because it's the girls or whatever, Ichi is there, and he has a couple members of Blue Pegasus, like Hibiki and Ren, and even and Jenny or whatever. Just to people to where they're not going to do anything to the main fight. Their job is to say, what can I do to support the people that can be in the main fight? I really want that for some of the fights. It doesn't have to. I really want it to be in any of like the fights that should feel like a really big boss battle, because the smaller support are important for stuff like that, where it's a massive group effort, and even small moves that support the other characters is really you know, I'm trying to use words. I feel like I'm gonna fuck it up. I'm just really important for their success. This is gonna be a long video. I have a lot to say about this chapter. But yeah, with all of that, we really know that there's some potential value of Cobra. So say if Blade, and because his sword is a snake, say his sword is like, oh, my sword has every single venom in the world all in it, and I can pick and choose what it is, or maybe they're all combined, and Cobra ends up fighting him, and Cobra fights, like, again, an ultimate poison sword demon dude. That'd be really cool. Because one thing, too, we don't have is we haven't had any hybrid modes. I don't really think we could get, like, a hybrid mode from it, but maybe, like, a new, like, something kind of different. Because there's the fact that we have a hybrid mode, because the how concept of hybrid modes, so you can tell my voice is, like, starting to trip a little bit. The whole point of, kind of difference with hybrid modes versus, like, drives is you have Sting and Rogue, they have Alakrima with the same attribute. They use that. It's essentially like a buff onto it. Whereas later, Future Rogue instead has Sting's Alakrima, so he, you know, is putting the white magic onto his shadows. And so I would assume that if we were to have a whole setup with that, that we would be able to... I had a pause real fast. That say, like, Cobra eats all this poison, maybe instead of it being, like, oh, a hybrid mode, he gets something kind of like a drive, or maybe, like, Poison Dragon King mode, to where it's such a poison boost. It's all these poisons all mixed. It's just, it all, like, intermingles and becomes this kind of pure mega poison that just puts him up to a massive Dragon Force state. I think it'd be really cool. Maybe it turns him into a dragon. That'd be sick. I'm just imagining, like, a big-ass Cobra dragon. Like, there's so many cool art bits that we're going to be getting, I would imagine. I can't say for sure, but I assume, just based off of the setup that we're going to be seeing. Because we have Cobra nearby, and I feel like what's going on, Cobra has to at some point get involved. There's other characters, obviously Sting and Rogue, but it's the ones that I think that are extra and maybe a little bit... wild cards, again, like Cobra, that'd be really cool. Or, like, if Agil or Invul showed up, you know, they busted them out of prison, and they said, all right, we gotta go help and do some stuff. I really like the ideas for some stuff like that. And it's, like, again, the idea, each of the main cast have their own, like, group, where they have a couple other characters who are able to fight, and then they have a bunch of support people who are just able to say, hey, I got your back. I think that'd be really, really cool. Because, like, imagine, too, Wendy as, like, Wendy as being a master support person, if she's able to focus on doing more so direct combat and, like, offensive enchantments and is able to not do nearly as much kind of side stuff and other characters can do it for her. I think that would really also help her just put her mind towards one thing and really kind of laser it towards success. There's a lot towards this... next bit that I think is really cool about this arc, this three-way faction war. And we have all these characters set up throughout 100 Years Quest that now can start to intermingle with the main cast. Is that how cool it'll be? It's like, oh yeah, Laxus shows up, and so does Kieran, and they're teaming up to go fight a dragon god, and we have them, like, teamed up with, like, Natsu, and they do, like, a three-man lightning attack between, Natsu using lightning dragon mode, Kieran using him is and Laxus his own lightning, and they just do all this big mega attack or something like that. I'm just trying to think of, like, the possibilities in there, really what you could do, because now these guys are all relatively on the same side. Like, you can get the members of the Moonlight Divinities and bring them over, because I bet they would want to help and deal with, like, trying to help with Selene now that Selene is causing problems over here. Be like, well, we aided her over here and caused problems, and this is their way to kind of redeem themselves. I think it would be really cool to come see them show up. Just like small characters like that in general, I would love to see just kind of involving themselves with each character respectively, and maybe some wild cards in there. Like, how cool would it be, just as, like, an example, how cool would it be if Jalal shows up, like, Urza goes to go to wherever Selene is, and in that whole scenario, Jalal shows up, and he not only is there, but he also brings, like, Miliana, Sho, and Wally, and they're able to do support, and then, bam, you also have Misaki show up, and so you have Erza, Misaki, and Jalal, and, you know, maybe, like, Minerva shows up, too, and then you also have a couple of, like, decent support characters, like, I don't really know what Miliana would do. Maybe she would, like, be good at, like, subduing the fodder dragons, but I don't really think so, because her, you know, the whole Neko tube only cancels out magic. It's not really going to do anything to dragons. Maybe she has, like, a new thing she could do, like, oh, it's reversed, then she wraps it around, you know, gives Erza, like, a little tube belt, and it's like, it's reversed, now it buffs your magic, like, I stored it that I took and then moved it somewhere else or something. Something useful kind of thing, because otherwise I don't really see what she's going to do. But, like, Sho with cards, I imagine Sho could do some cool moves. Maybe he could help, like, just do some support stuff, or he... Actually, that'd be really cool if he could just kind of, like, oh, yeah, I started to, like, store these useful items in my cards, and it's just stuff for to kind of, like, aid Erza. Maybe they have, like, a sword. That'd actually be really cool. I would really like to be like, oh, we've actually been on a journey the last while. We've gotten, we got this sword that we wanted to give Erza that we've been holding on to, and we've been wanting to see her for years, but we didn't know if she was ready. It's some legendary sword that is just like, gives Erza like a new thing. I don't know. I'm just trying to think of something really cool that you could do off that. I just like imagine seeing us like, essentially handing her like a Yu-Gi-Oh card, and she's just like in awe of this sword she maybe has heard about once or twice. And then she's like, well, how do I get it out of here? And he's like, I don't know. I think stuff like that would be really fun. Like, there's a lot of neat little bits that are all in potential laying out because of how, again, the main cast is separated. None of them, I think, can really do this setup on their own, except for maybe Natsu. Because, like, the Lacrima is not the problem. It's everything that is a danger around it. Because you have all these fodder dragons, and as we see this chapter from Caramel, that she is now a dragon too. Like, she's somebody I imagine Lucy is going to be able to beat. But she is somebody who is just a random human turning into a dragon. Like, she's not anybody special. So, like, she's going to be somebody that should be, I would imagine, strong, especially if she's a water dragon and she's in the water. She's going to be at the advantage. But she's somebody that, just based off of from A to B, I don't really see that she's going to be, like, unsurmountable for Lucy to defeat. Where it's like, okay, yeah, now Merc's here. Yeah, Lucy's figure out a plan to get around this. And that's just the last thing I want to talk about this chapter. I don't have anything to really say about, like, all the fodder dragons. Obviously, we see a bunch of the Ermina members, like, the just general, like, the concierge. I forgot his name. We got Sharkette and all of them. They are all, like, little dragons. Nothing really crazy in design. They're just kind of, like, little humanoid dragons for the most part, not fully transformed. But they're chasing Lucy at one point, and they smash the ground, and she falls, and she's in water. But then when she looks back up, everything is just water. So I wonder if this is, like, some, like, dimensional ability. Like, she... Like, maybe Caramel put, like, a layer of water essentially under it, and then you fall into it, but now you're essentially in this, like, pocket water dimension. Like, you're in, like, this... Almost like being in, like, a little shadow puddle. I'm trying to think, because, like, the first thing I thought of, is just because it's a recent, was Nocht. I know it's, like, it's the same thing that, like, that we know happens when Rogue goes into a shadow, but, like, just the most recent one that I thought of was Nocht from Black Clover. It's like, go in your shadow. It's its own little pocket zone. And inside there, maybe that's kind of what she's doing. And kind of like how Nocht and how Rogue, and as we see Sting go into the shadow, it's its own kind of realm of existence. And that's what she's doing. She has her own little water zone that she's done. Very curious to see how this is going to go. Because she's in this kind of just partial state. She's got horns. She's got like ears and claws and a tail. I want to see what her design is looking like. I'm guessing she's going to look kind of like more... What's that one bubble shooting dragon from Monster Hunter? I can't remember what it's called. But just like looking like this big kind of maned up serpent dragon. Not like how Merc is more of like... More kind of fish-like. More of aquatic with like the type of like... Are they dorsal fins? They're technically wings. You know what I mean? The way they're designed and how his just general body is shaped. She's probably gonna have something similar to that. Very curious to how this fight is gonna go, because we know also other people are gonna be showing up to each of these locations. Because I would assume that the Irasion Sects are gonna be wanting to destroy the Lacrima too, so they're gonna have to be doing other things. But still, this is gonna be the first problem, and until this is stopped, what's gonna come after that, and who's gonna be showing up after that? Also, just as a side thing, just as a neat little detail too, if you look at Caramiel, the top of her hair is like just the tip, like a little bit of the curl is out of the water. So she's kind of like a shark. So I wonder if she's going to be like a shark dragon. If that's supposed to be kind of like her fin, her little bit of hair. I think that's actually a really neat little detail. I just noticed that. Because it's the only part of her body that is shaded a little bit like it's above the water. Very neat little detail. So I know this is like an hour-long video. I've had a lot to say. I feel like there's a lot going on right now, and there's a lot that's going to be happening in the next couple of chapters. This is pretty much what I expected, this bit. The only thing that was different than what I thought this chapter is, I thought we wouldn't have as much from the main cast, and we would see a little bit from the Fire and Flames members, but maybe that's something Mishima's saving, and we're only going to see one of their dragon forms at a time, which makes sense. I don't think he's going to throw every single dragon form at us all at once. Same thing, we're probably not going to see every single Aetherius form of the OS all at once. We're probably going to see them all as they go, which will make them more hype. I think that will be really fun just to see. And then who goes where and what. Again, tell me in the comments, and this is one of the last things I want to talk about. Obviously, like, I want to hear what everyone's fights. Like, who do you want to see fight who? You know, we have obviously the main cast members. We know relatively the members of Diablos. We could get a couple random members, and same thing with Fire and Flames. But who in it? Because we have like Diablos, we have Fire and Flames, we have the Irasion Sects, Fairy Tail, potentially Mimi and her group. I'm trying to think, Brandish and any of the Spriggan 12 that are still around and able to do anything. I doubt Damari is going to show up. Anybody that is relevant. Obviously, we have people, Jalal, Laxus, Gildart, Sting and Rogue. Minerva seems to be like she's got, if she works a little bit harder, she can kind of get into that like more fair area. But she definitely should be able to hang if she shows up, especially if she focuses on more support and helping aid the people around her with her territory magic. There's a lot just to where like the fights can kind of get all weirdly placed. Tell me what ones you want to see and where you're at with it. So, other than that though, like what exactly are you hoping for Zero? I really like the idea of Natsu versus Zero rematch, but I kind of want it to be Gray. I kind of like the idea of Gray fighting him instead, because though Natsu has the direct history with Zero, I really like the idea of the I really like the Irasion Sects being more of Gray's thing. I think it'd be much cooler if you have essentially like a dragon progressing side and a demon progressing side, because we already have Urza with the Belsarion sword, and with the demons, we actually have a really good opportunity to have Mira Jane be relevant again. Like, again, if you've made it to the end of this video, I've gotten a lot of shit for memeing on Mira Jane, but it's mostly on the fact that like I'm very realistic about where she is power wise, and we have problems of like understanding like does she still have some of the Tartarus souls? Because if Xerath died, like did the souls disappear or are they kind of to her now? I imagine they're to her now, but like we don't know for a fact. But now she has other powerful demons that she can add to her repertoire, and other things that she can bring in and to kind of be relevant again, because this is a good opportunity for her, and I'm very excited. And I really would like it. It's like Gray and her and maybe a couple others are dealing with stuff over there, and you could have stuff like, oh, Juvia's relevant, Elfman's relevant. They can have like moments fighting some of these guys, like Elfman versus Gaia. That could be really pretty potential. Like we know Elfman is actually a pretty capable character in terms of pretty much just strength and durability, like in the relevant area, like Spriggan tier. But he gets gapped by how slow he is, and people just run numbers on him. And it's like, yeah, he can hurt them if he can land a hit, but he could almost never land hits, and he just gets pummeled, and he just gets completely like caught in hacks and stuff. And that's obviously Elfman's problem that he's been doing. And I wish that he would like, literally just take a timeout and go work on his damn speed. But maybe there's a fight there that we can have. Who knows? I think that would be really cool to actually give him, like, a really big battle. And it wouldn't just be, yeah, Natsu and Urza are going to defeat these guys. Lucy's going to defeat this person. I really like it. It's like we have a much bigger spread of events to where we can bring some of the other characters over. And on top of that, I really like the idea of having a Fire and Flames and a Arathion sex member just fight. Like, nobody from the main cast. Just two villains fighting each other. I think that would be really cool. But anyway, other than that, I know this is, again, this is like an hour-long video. I think I just hit an hour on it. But I have a lot to say on this chapter. There's a lot just spreading out. There's a lot of new information. There's a lot of just bits to talk. Like, I did like a 20-minute segment just talking about Zero. Like, I am so hyped just to see this dude active. Because I mentioned it, too. And this is one of the last things I'll bring up. Zero was the main villain, ongoing villain in the series when I started. So seeing him back, not as an illusion, not as a zombie with his face, actually him, I'm so stoked. I can't wait to see him fight, because I know also, we know his abilities. We don't have to wait to see what he can do. We know what he can do, so everything is just going to be an addition to it. And we know this dude just wants to put hands on stuff, and he just wants to smash and destroy things. But he's already got development, and he's dedicated to it. So it's like he's not just going to go out there and make say a bunch of stuff and run into a wall. I think it's gonna be Bird. Codename is Bird, man. Maybe he'll surprise me, who knows, but we'll see. Yeah, I mean, this chapter I thought was really, really good. The only part that I would really say, again, that was like not crazy to go over was just parts of like when the main cast was talking about their plan, just because I feel like for the most part, unless that they had some form of communication going into it when they're going over, they definitely rushed into this. Like, the main cast did not really take into account, like, some of the problems I think they'll run into, but I feel like it's gonna be that because we don't see them really travel or anything off screen, that they contacted some people on the travel over, which I think also would make sense. They don't have to have, yeah, I've got 30 people coming to your location. Just have, like, 4 people. Like, yeah, these people are showing up to come help you. Because their main problem is really, is Merc. Merc, and then we don't really know about the Fire and Flames members. Obviously, their problems. The Arathion Sex members are problems. But we don't know if they're there yet. The main things, obviously, are the Dragon Gods. If the Dragon Gods try and stop you from getting the Lacrima, what exactly are you planning to do about it? You know? So, that's just kind of the whole bit at the end. Like, is they need to get other people on their side to kind of aid, just to come aid them. Otherwise, they're going to be in a really rough spot. But anyway, comment below, like I said, what fights you want to see. If you like the long video, again, I had a lot just to kind of go over and a lot just to comment on this chapter. And I'm really excited to see where all these things really play out in the next bit. I think Lucy's 2 is going to really kind of tell us a lot of like how bits are going to go, because we're going to be seeing what the general plan is going to be, who's going to be showing up, what exactly is the tactic plan of the other two factions. It's not just the rampaging dragon gods and the dragons in their locations. It's also, again, two other groups that have their own schemes going on and their own members that could pop up at any time. But yeah, other than that, comment below, thumbs up the video, perform the like button, subscribe button, and check out my other videos. For that, appreciate every star subscribe, and I thank you all for listening. Bye.